coming up on From Glory to Glory.
The people who see the angels, they mistaken them for God and they begin to worship. It will be an angel that says to them, don't worship because I am a fellow servant. Why? Because of the glory of God that is upon them. Now, if the glory is upon the angels in that way, can you imagine Adam who walked with God each and every day in the garden?
As I look in the mirror back home on the lawn, I am changed to his likeness. From glory to glory, from power to power, from strength to strength, I will never be.
In line with our Passover theme, redemption, we have also declared this month to be the month of abundant redemption. Amen. Abundant redemption, taken from this scripture, Psalm 130 and verse number 7. The Bible says, O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is mercy, and with him is abundant redemption. Somebody say abundant redemption. One more time, abundant redemption. One last time, abundant redemption. Hallelujah. And that is how we have also themed our Passover convention this year. Redeemed. You know, you and I have been redeemed. Now, it's very much important for us to know, and it is very clear in the scriptures, that you and I belong to God. Whether you are a Christian or not, but in one way or the other, we belong to God. It is very clear in the scriptures that it was God who created us. The Bible says in Genesis chapter number 1, verse 26, then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So when God created man, that is exactly what he wanted to create, right? When God made man in his image, that is exactly what he wanted, all right? He did not make something else, and then out of that, then man evolved. It doesn't matter what you've been told at school. Amen. The fact that you are a Christian, you and I, we believe that we were created by God as men and nothing else. Amen. Let me ask you something, Bazan and Bam. If you can, it's actually an example that I had a man, you know, called, I think, Dr. Ngwebe, making this example, that if you can go to the moon, right? Okay, let's choose another planet. What's another planet where no one has been there before? Mars. No one has been to Mars before. Jupiter. Right, let's choose Jupiter. Let's say, by God's grace, you are the first to go there. At least that's what you think. Then you land the first day, you get off your spaceship or whatever it is that they use when they go there, and when, as soon as you jump out, you find a Rolex watch in Jupiter. Can I ask you something? Will you think that Rolex, it was just by chance that it was there? Or your common sense will tell you that because it's a watch and it functions in a particular way, there must be a designer behind this watch. And chances are, kukhona umuntu oke wafika lapho before you. So it's shocking to think that we as men, we find planet Earth, we find all the stars, the moon, we find human beings designed to function in a particular way. And we refuse to believe that there must be a designer behind the way. I mean, look at yourself. You have a nose, you have two eyes, you have two ears. The way that they've been positioned to function in a particular way, two legs. I mean, come to think of it. Why didn't we have, until we have legs and feet? That's what we call it. Right? We have legs and then feet, right? Why are our feet not the other way around? No, it's just a simple question. Why? Because we were going to be out of balance and fall, right? So there must have been someone who thought about that kind of a design. So to suggest to me that, you know, all of these things happen by chance. As I said to you, I can't remember when did I say this, that God is so consistent even in his creation in such a way that we never wake up and all of a sudden the sun rises from the west. It has never happened. And it shall never happen. Because there was a desire, and no matter how scientific you can be, you can never change that. You can never say, we are now scientifically inclined. We've found a way of making the sun to rise from the east, from the west, and to set from on the west. It can never happen. So you and I were created by God. We belong to God. We are God's property. God himself in heaven, what did he say? Let us make man in our image. It's simple. You don't have to make a research. The Bible has already given you the answer. Don't waste money on anything else. All right? Now, and then in 27 it says, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Verse 28, then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. And take note, from before this happens in verse 26, from verse number 3, the Bible tells us that God has been creating or declaring things into existence, all right? He said, let there be light, and there was light. So when God creates man, and he says to them, be fruitful and multiply. Guess what happens? They were fruitful and then they began to multiply and to flourish. Amen. He blessed them. Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Now, every creator or maker of a particular product owns that product. It rightfully belongs to that creator and maker because it is his own product. It is his own design. It is his own creation. It is his own, you know, whatever it is. You know, when I've designed a car and nobody else has ever designed it, it belongs to me. It's mine. It rightfully belongs to me, legally so. Amen. And that particular product, it will be and it will operate the way that its maker has designed it, right? The Bible tells us that when God created us, what did he say? The Bible says he blessed us. And guess what? If God blessed us as our creator in the beginning, it means that we are blessed because our maker declared us blessed. He made us to be blessed. And for any other person to alter or to change anything to the product and to cause it to operate differently, he must first have the legal right to do so. He must first buy it, or wait for the owner to discard it or to disown it. You cannot take someone else's product and redesign it and cause it to function differently from the way that it was originally designed. You must first have the legal right to own it. That's why in most cases, you will see Samsung suing Apple or suing, no, I think it was Nokia who sued the other two, saying to them, but the concept of a touchscreen came with us. You had no right to take that concept and remake it and do it the way that it suits your softwares and whatever the case may be, because this is our product. That's why we have something called a copyright. You cannot change what I own until you have my permission. And you can either buy the right to do so from me or wait for me to disown the product, to discard it and say, I don't want it anymore. I want nothing to do with this product. And then ungazidobela now. That's why you have no right taking another man's husband. Just for control, you are taking another woman's husband. This person is a product. He never used to be like this before. You should have taken him before he got married. Probably he had no teeth. He was not brushing his teeth properly. Probably he was wearing the wrong way around. And this poor woman takes this man, cleans him up a bit, makes him nice. And you come from nowhere. You take, illegally so, you take someone else's husband. What's the matter for you? What's the matter for you? What's the matter for you? Leave that man alone. It's not your product. Find your own and make your own. Find your own dirty one. Clean him up. Help the brother out. Find someone else. I'm not saying go and find someone who's dead. I'm not. What's the matter for you? Be creative. Find your own. So we belong to God. Before anyone can change anything, we first had to be disowned or discarded, because even the enemy himself had no legal right to change anything with our lives. That's why even when Satan wants to alter or to change Job's life, he did not have access to him. That's why he went to God frustrated. When God said to him, have you seen my servant Job? What did Satan say in Job chapter number 1 and verse 8? The Bible says, then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil? Verse 9, so Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him, around his household, and around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. Now, this is Satan, whom the Bible describes as the thief who kills and destroys. But he comes to God. He says to God, look, my man, don't tell me about Job. You've built a hedge around him. I can't do anything with this dude. I can't change anything. Why? Because Job is God's product. You cannot, as Satan, come and do as you please with my people without me giving you permission. It was only after God said to him, go and do whatever that you want to do, but don't touch his soul. And then, I'm sure Satan was excited, but God wanted to demonstrate something to him, and we know that at the end, God restored him. Amen. So each and every one of us, when we were created, God's original plan for us was to make us his product, eternally so, to belong to him, so that he can put his stamp of trademark, copyright, whatever it is upon us, so that no one can change us, no one can alter us, no one can change the way that we think, the way that we operate. And the devil knew that. He knew that exactly, that there is absolutely nothing that he can do. Amen. But the unfortunate thing that happens then is that sin came into the picture and it separated us from God. Remember, I said, if a person wants to change someone else's product, he must wait for that person or the owner to discard it, to disown it, all right? or he can rightfully so buy the rights to do so, all right? So Adam and Eve carried the blessing and they were supposed to multiply it here on earth.
Strengthen your faith with this powerful book by the anointed author, Pastor Jacob Msimpa.
I don't know which mountain are you faced with, but you shall say to this mountain. Maybe your mountain is the fact that you are broke down and out, but Jesus says, whosoever has got faith in God.
This book is filled with biblical principles that will help you fight the good fight of faith, and it is a powerful tool for every believer.
All things are possible to him who is wise. He does not say all things are possible to him who is rich. He does not say all things are possible to him who comes from a rich family. But he says all, not some. He says all things are possible to him who believes. The question is, do you believe?
You can get this book for only 80 rands by calling us on 086-722-7247 or by emailing us on orders@yara.co.za or via our online store. This book is also available as an ebook for only 60 rands. Get yours now.
Have fallen short of the glory of the Lord. Each and every one of us, no matter how good you can be, if you were born and you did not drink, you did not smoke, but we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Amen. It is not you not smoking, not drinking that makes you to be sinless, but it is the blood of Jesus Christ that can make you sinless. Amen. And sin, Bazalwane bami, short circuits the flow of the power of God in your life in such a way that no matter how much God wants to bless you, but if there is sin that is in control in your life, if God himself in the fullness of his power, in the fullness of his might, in the fullness of his wisdom, there is nothing much that he can do in your life. It's up to you to stop that sin before it stops you. If you don't stop the sin, eventually it will catch up and take you out. Alibongwe igama lenkosi bazalwane. That's why the Bible then encourages us in the book of Hebrews chapter number 12 verse 1. It says, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. So sin does what in your life? It becomes the burden, it becomes the weight, it slows us down, it ensnares us, it traps us, it causes us to be limited in the blessing that the Lord wanted us to walk in, the blessing that the Lord wanted us to experience in our lives. When we entertain a sinful life, when we fool around with the devil and whatever it is that he is behind, this sin ensnares us. It slows us down. We cannot run the race that we are, you know, the way that we are supposed to. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter number 59 and verse 1, God says, behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save. God can save. His hand is not shortened. And then it says, nor his ear heavy that it cannot hear. In other words, when we pray, God's ears are not dull so that he is not going to hear you when you pray. But verse 2 explains what is it that is happening. Because many of us, we are seated here today. You can have many questions and say to yourself, if God is the God of all power, if God is the God of all wisdom, why are people suffering the way that they are suffering? Why can't God do, you know, as he pleases? Why can't God deliver people? Why can't God kill Mugabe? Why can't God remove Jacob Zuma? Why can't God do something about everything which is wrong here on earth? How come that there are people who are hungry out there? Poverty is killing them. They have no water. They have no housing and so forth and so on. But verse 2 says, your sin, your iniquities have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not hear. Even if his ears are not dull, even if his hand is not too short, but as soon as there is sin between me and God, the Bible says it hinders the way that God can operate in my life. So even if he wants me blessed, let me tell you something. God wants to see each and every one of us blessed. And it is possible. It's just that abaningi bathanda bomamlambo ukudlula uNkulunkulu. So there's nothing much that God can do. God can look at you. He can desire that if only you knew. If only you knew what I wanted to do. But the Bible says, your iniquities, your sin have hidden my face from you. I cannot even look at you. God is so righteous in such a way that he cannot even look at sin. As a matter of fact, each time God looks at sin, he wants to kill. He wants to destroy. Amen. Now, the deal here is, when Adam allowed sin to come into the picture, it was not just the issue of sin that God was going to deal with here, but it was also going to be the consequences of sin. Because sin resulted in alienation from God. It resulted in death. It resulted in sickness. It resulted in poverty. All of these things were not meant to be. We were supposed to live a sinless life, poverty-free life. We were supposed to live eternally in him. There was not supposed to be anything called a headache. Let me explain it in this way. Some of you have heard me use this example before. It's like when God said to Adam and Eve, look, my man, you can eat everything here in the garden, right? But, please get me my handkerchief, some bleef. But you're younger than me, ne? So I have the rights to send you. Amen. Hallelujah. So here's the deal. God says to Adam and Eve, look, I've put you in the garden. I've given you everything here to enjoy. Okay? Says you can eat whatever fruit. I don't know what kind of fruits were there. You know, I don't think it was these kinds of fruits that we have today. I don't know. Probably it was something, some kind of a food that when you eat, look, the ground that we are walking on now, it was cursed. That is the ground that we are planting for. So that ground was so fertile, it was watered by God himself. The Bible says there was a river from heaven that flowed into that garden. So you can imagine the kinds of fruit and trees that were there. You can imagine. You can imagine. Apparently, Adam in the Garden of Eden, he was so full of authority, he traveled at the speed of thought. So in other words, when he thinks I'm on the other side of the garden, he's there. That's why he walked in so much authority in such a way that when the Lord brought animals before him, whatever he named them, they became. So every animal, so the anaconda came. So he was so much full of authority in such a way that when they saw Adam, they couldn't differentiate between Adam and God, because the glory of God was upon Adam. That's why they could not, the lion could not roar at Adam. The dog could not bark at him. Have you ever had this theory that I know this is going to be a controversial example, but let me use it anyway. But there is this theory that says, mawuzwa izinja zishaya mkulungwane. I don't know what's that in English. When the dogs are hitting them mkulungwane. They are? Growling, when they are making those funny noises at night, other than barking, you know, it's howling. Yes, when they are making those funny sounds, you know, other than barking. And then they will tell you that they are seeing some let me just say, supernatural figure. Right? It is said. Now, in other words, whatever that they are seeing overwhelms them in such a way that they cannot operate that the way they are supposed to operate. You know, when a dog sees you, because it's not afraid of you, it's going to bark at you because it's trying to, you know, pose a threat that I'm about to bark. But when it sees this figure, then it starts, you know, howling and surrendering and doing like, yo, I'm not sure about this one. I've never seen this one before. Amen. Let me give you another example. In heaven, the Bible says the elders, the 24 elders, what are they doing? 24 hours each and every second. Not like once per hour, but every second. What do? They can't do anything else. They bow down and declare the holiness of God. Why? Because God is so great, they cannot even behold him for a second. Each time after bowing down, saying you are holy, when they are about to rise up and see his greatness, they bow down again. Now, the glory of God was upon Adam in such a way that when the animals approached him, it looked like God. It looked like God. That's why even the Bible tells us that when Moses was passing by the tree, the burning bush, he noticed something different that ngeke ngawubona umlilo before. But this kind, even the bush itself is not consumed. And the Bible tells us that he was told, take off your shoes. I mean, if you are hearing that kind of a voice, you cannot help it, but bow down and worship. That's why even when angels show up in the Bible, the people who see the angels, they mistaken them for God and they begin to worship. It will be an angel that says to them, don't worship because I am a fellow servant. Why? Because of the glory of God that is upon them. Now, if the glory is upon the angels in that way, can you imagine Adam who walked with God each and every day in the garden?
To order today's message and other sermons preached at BCC, you can call us, email us, or visit our online store. These messages are available as digital downloads and also as DVDs and CDs. Follow us on social media by liking and sharing our Facebook page. You can also subscribe to our YouTube channel to watch and download videos from BCC. We're also on Instagram and you can follow us to see the latest photos of our ministry. For powerful nuggets of the messages preached at BCC, you can follow us on Twitter. You can also watch our services live through livestream.com. Connect with us now and be blessed.